If you're in the field of software development, you must have heard about the word idempotence. Maybe in the context of REST APIs, or maybe somebody asked about this in an interview. Either way, this is something that people have a rough idea on, but are not 100% clear on this concept. That ends today. Hello world, my name is Monis, and today we will talk about the concept of idempotence. At the end of this video, you will be able to clearly understand what idempotence is as a concept. Why and how is it used in the REST APIs? And most importantly, some real-world applications and examples to see how is it relevant in the real life. So let's get started. Imagine a bulb with a switch. You flip the switch, it is switched on. You flip it again, it is switched off. So every time you flip the switch, the state of the bulb changes. But what if there were two buttons instead of a single switch? One to switch the bulb on, and another to switch the bulb off. If the bulb was off initially, and you press the on button, the bulb will switch on. If you press on again, nothing will happen. The bulb will continue to work. It doesn't matter if you press it one time or 100 times, it will continue to stay on. Or we can simply say that the state of the bulb after the first press of the button and the state of the bulb after you press the button n times would exactly be the same. That is the on state. Now, if you press the off button, the bulb will switch off. And if you repeat this operation multiple times, nothing will happen. The bulb will continue to stay off. Again, the state of the bulb after the first press of the button and the state of the bulb after you press this button n times is exactly the same. This is precisely what idempotence is about. Idempotence is originally a mathematical concept, and this term was coined by an American mathematician called Benjamin Pierce in 1870. This word literally means the quality of having the same power. But how does this relate to the concept of computer science and mathematics? Let's try to find out with an example. So we'll write two functions. Function 1, which takes an integer as an input, adds 10 and returns the value. So when the input is 5, it should return 15. And when the input is -2, it should return 8, and so on. And then we define function number 2, which takes an integer and returns its absolute value. In very simple terms, the absolute value of an integer is simply its positive counterpart, which would mean that the absolute value of -1 would be 1. For -20, it will be 20. And if the integer is positive, then the value remains the same. So let's try to implement these functions. So first, we have our function 1, which takes an integer, adds 10, and returns the value. And then we have the function 2, which takes an integer and returns its positive counterpart. And finally, we have a main method to invoke these two functions to test them out. So the first function with -100 as an input should return -90, and the second function with the same input should return 100. Let's see if it works. And so it does. Now, mathematically, a function is said to be idempotent if this expression is true. Now, let's try to see if the functions that we defined match this expression or not. Let's talk about our first function, that is our increment function. Fx will become increment of x, and f of fx will become increment of x. At this point, we'll simply try to see if they're equal or not. If they are, then this method is idempotent, and if they're not, then it's not idempotent. So let's try to run this and see what is the result. As you can see, this method is not idempotent. Now let's try to go to the second function. We repeat all the steps, but we will replace the increment function with the absolute function. So let's try to run this again and see what is the result. As expected, this function is idempotent. So now, if we try to phrase this concept into a single sentence, we can say that an operation is idempotent if it can be repeated multiple times in such a way that the result after the first execution and the result after n executions is exactly the same. Now, idempotence was all clear until the time the functions were returning something, so that we could pass the return value back into the function, and we could find idempotency using the mathematical expression. But what about the functions which do not return a value, like the add method of list in Java? Or what about the functions which do return a value, but it cannot be passed back into the function, like the add method of a set in Java, which returns a boolean? Let's try to dig a little bit deeper here. Imagine a set with values 1, 2, and 4. A set is a type of data structure which does not allow any duplicates. It means that in the current set, if I try to add 2, that is an element which already exists in the set, the value of the set would remain the same as before. Now, let's say that I add a new value which doesn't already exist in the set, like the number 3. The first time we add the number 3 to the set will change its state. But if I repeat this operation and try to add the number 3 a few more times, it will not be added in the set. So the result after the first execution and the result after, let's say, 3 executions, they are exactly the same. This means that the add method of set is idempotent. Now, let's try to take another example. An example of a list with the values 1, 2, and 4. Now, a list doesn't care if it has duplicates or not. So let's try to add a number 3 to the list. Now, let's try to repeat this operation and add 3 again. The number is added again to the list. So if we repeat the same operation n number of times, the list will change every time. So the result after the first execution and the result after every subsequent execution is different. So the add method of list is not idempotent. So similarly, you can apply this concept to any of the functions and figure out whether a function is idempotent or not. A very important point to note here is that the result doesn't always mean the data returned from the function. The result refers to the data on which the operations are being performed on. We talked about a lot of functions which modify the data and learn to find out if they are idempotent or not. But what about the functions which do not change the data? Like a function which returns the elements of a list. The rule is, if it's not changing the data, it is idempotent. Plain and simple. So if we have a list with elements 1, 2, and 4, and we have a getList method which returns the elements of the list, the first time we execute it, it returns 1, 2, and 4. Now let's say that the element 3 was added to the list, and we call the getList again. At this point, it returns different data from before. Now, in this case, the data is being modified by the add function. The getList method doesn't have anything to do with changing the result. For this reason, it will always be idempotent, even if the function returns different values every time it is called. Again, remember that the result doesn't always mean the data returned from the function. We all use REST APIs, don't we? Sometime or the other, we must have heard about the concept of idempotency in relation to the REST APIs. Based on the foundation that we have established, we will try to find out how idempotency is achieved in REST. It is a common misconception that if a request gets the same response every time it is invoked, the request is idempotent. This is completely incorrect. Let's try to oversimplify things a little bit. REST APIs usually try to do two actions. They either try to modify the data through create, update, or delete operations, or they don't modify the data, which is the read operation. The ones which don't modify the data are get, head, options, and trace. These methods are used to fetch some kind of data from the server without modifying anything. Now, we will not go into depth of each of these request methods because that is out of the scope for this video, but we can at least deduce from our original definition of idempotence that anything which doesn't modify the data is idempotent. Therefore, we can simply say that all these methods are idempotent. Now, let's talk about the request methods which do modify the data. They are put, post, patch, and delete. Now, according to the RFC 7231 by Internet Engineering Task Force, put and delete must be idempotent, whereas post and patch can also do without being idempotent. It simply means that these methods are not guaranteed to be idempotent. They might be or they might not be, but they are not guaranteed. Now, these request methods are not going to be magically idempotent. We have to implement them correctly. So let's try to dig a little bit deeper. We all shop online, shoes, clothes, mobile phones, and sometimes even gifts. One crucial part of shopping online is that whatever you buy gets delivered to your home. And when it comes to delivery, then we have to give out our address. Now, imagine a case that you were filling out your home address, and because of a typo, you mistyped your house number to 128 instead of 182. So naturally, you would like to update this address. In such a case, you would like to override the existing information with some new information. So the update request might look somewhat like this. Now, irrespective of how many times we send the same request, the resulting data in the system should be overridden. This essentially means that repeating the same request will have the same result. In other words, we can simply say that this behavior is idempotent. In cases when you want this kind of a behavior, use the put method. If we have a look at RFC 7231, it clearly states that a put method is used to replace the state and is intended to be idempotent. Not update, replace. Coming back to our request methods, put must be idempotent. Now that you have updated your address and everything, it's time to place the order. An oversimplified version of the place order request might look somewhat like this. Now, after placing the order, you just realize that instead of buying two shirts, you only bought one. And now the order has been placed and you cannot change it. So what do? You add the item to your cart again and place the order once again. In this case, you'll essentially repeat the same request. Now, think about what is the state on the server. Earlier, you had one order, now you should have two. So if you repeat this request multiple times, the state on the server changes every time. This means that this behavior is not idempotent. And whenever you want such a behavior, use post. So now we can conclude that the post method is not guaranteed to be idempotent. It means it might be or it might not be, but it is not guaranteed. Let's try to take another example of e-commerce websites. There are a lot of items we want to buy, but we want to wait until those items are on sale. So what do we do in this case? We add these items to our wishlist so that when any of the items in the wishlist are on sale, we can buy them immediately. But sometimes we also remove items from our wishlist just because we don't want them anymore. So a request to delete an item from a wishlist could simply look like this. This request would essentially delete an item with this ID from your wishlist. Now let's assume that the state of the server in terms of wishlist was this. After running the delete request for this ID, the state of the server is this. Now, if we repeat this request, there is nothing to delete anymore with that ID. So repeating the same request would not delete anything more. This means that the result after the first execution and the result after multiple executions will exactly be the same. This confirms to our original definition of idempotence. Therefore, delete is guaranteed to be idempotent. So, we previously discussed about the put method where we resend the whole resource to the server so that it replaces the server state and therefore is idempotent. But consider a case when you have a 2000 page document on the server and you only want to change line number 5. Does it make sense to resend the whole document of 2000 lines again? Wouldn't it be better if somehow we could update the line number 5 directly without resending the whole document? Well, this is where the patch method comes into play. It is used to update the resource on the server. This is very different from put, which was used to replace the state of the resource. So a patch request to replace a line of a document on the server could look somewhat like this, where we mention a document ID and the line number in the request URL, whereas the request body can contain the updated data. Now let's talk a little bit about the idempotence of this method. If we repeat this request multiple times, the update will happen for the first time, but the subsequent requests will simply result in the same state of the document. That is, line number 5 of the document will always be what it was in the request. Does that mean that this operation is idempotent? Well, so far it looks idempotent. We can repeat this request multiple times and it will have the same effect on the document as was the first time when we executed the request. Now, let's take another scenario. What if we still want to update the document, but instead of replacing a particular line, we simply add it at the end of the document? Our request could look somewhat like this. Now, if we repeat this request multiple times, it will add this line to the end of the document every time this is executed, which means the state on the server changes after each execution. So, does it still look idempotent? Well, as you can probably guess, no, it is not idempotent. So in certain situations, this method is idempotent, and in other situations, it is not. This is exactly what we mean by the phrase, patch method is not guaranteed to be idempotent. It might be, it might not be, but it is not guaranteed. For more details on the patch method, feel free to have a look at RFC 5789. Link is down in the description. I hope this makes the concept of idempotency a lot clearer in the context of REST APIs. Now let's talk about a very real-life scenario where idempotency can be a real lifesaver as an engineering practice. When two services are communicating with each other, let's say using REST APIs, a lot can go wrong. The connection may not be established, which means that the request never reached the server. Connection was established, but the operation failed while in execution. Or the connection was established, operation also completed, but there was an error while returning the response. Now, we can simply retry the request programmatically for it to go through. But let's think about a tricky scenario. Let's say that you're implementing a payment service which takes some money from the customer's account when they buy something on your website. Now, the payment request could look somewhat like this. In this case, a user is trying to make a purchase for $200. Now, tomorrow, the user could come back and try to buy something else, which also costs exactly $200. So, essentially, we want to allow the same request to be repeated, and we want to deduct $200 every time the user repeats this request. So we decide, okay, let's make this a post request because we don't want idempotency here. Every time we run it, we want to change the state on the server. Now let's say that the user makes a payment, but this request fails. So we retry the request automatically. Now, if the connection was not established previously, it might establish now, and the request could go through. So essentially, the retry would work and $200 will be deducted from the user. Now, let's think about another scenario. If the connection was established previously, but the operation failed while in execution, this means that the money wasn't taken from the user's account. So we retry the request, which works this time, and $200 are deducted from the user's account. So far, the retries seem to solve our problems. But there can be also a tricky situation. So let's say that the connection was established, operation also succeeded at the target server, but there was a problem while returning the response. This means that the $200 were deducted for the purchase, but we got the response that the request failed. Now, since for us, the request failed, we retry the operation and the $200 will be deducted again for the same purchase. That can be a very bad experience for the customer. So let's try to streamline the problem a little bit. We don't want the operation to be 100% idempotent, so post was probably the right choice, because we want the money to be deducted every time the request is repeated. But we don't want this behavior when there is a failure or a retry. So in other words, normally we don't want this operation to be idempotent, but we want this to be idempotent in a specific scenario of a retry. A very simple approach to solve this problem is to have something called an idempotency key in the headers. Every time a new request is placed, a new idempotency key is generated and sent with the request. However, in case of a retry, the idempotency key from the previous failed request can be reused to enforce idempotent behavior only in case of retries. When the server receives a request, it can extract the idempotency key and check the payment status corresponding to that idempotency key. If payment status indicates that the money was already deducted, then the server simply returns the correct response without deducting any more money. But if the money was not deducted previously, then the server deducts the money and then returns the response. So this way, we can ensure that the idempotent behavior is observed only in case of retries, and the customer is charged only once, even in the case of multiple retries. So if you're ever using a payment service and you have been charged twice without any reason, then it's a clear indication that their engineers are not familiar with the concept of idempotence, and you should tag them in this video. So there you have it. I hope you have a much better clarity on the concept of idempotence. Write down in the comments below if you have any questions. See you in the next video. Bis dann.